Man,
I've been trying to get as lean as can be, and I am still one of those folks who struggles with just that like little bit of what looks like belly fat down here. But folks, what if this isn't belly fat? Maybe there's something going on movement-wise that could be contributing to your abdominal contents sitting lower, giving you the appearance of a pooch belly. Hello, everybody. Zach Couples, physical therapist here. And folks, although that lower bulge in your ab wall could be caused by medical stuff, it could be that's just where you carry body fat. It could be because you have extra body fat on you, or it could be because of some gut issue or gut dysbiosis. What's often under-discussed and underutilized is the movement component that could also be contributing to having a pooch belly. And that's what we're gonna talk about in today's video. I'm gonna teach you wonderful, outstanding people the biomechanical reasons why someone may have their abdominal contents sitting more down and forward, as well as three of my favorite movement strategies to help teach you to push the guts higher up so the pooch belly is minimized and you have a little bit of less of that distension. Is having a pooch belly more influenced by our body structure than it is belly fat? We're gonna discuss the biomechanical considerations as to why that might be the case. And folks, this isn't going to be too much over your head. Your boy is expert status at making things ridiculously simple. But to help us out, I'm going to call on a cool study that I had read by Talaz et al. This study contained a theoretical model that illustrated why some individuals have abdominal viscera, not necessarily belly fat, but the viscera, so your intestines, stuff like that, why it sits lower in some folks than others. And it has to do with the ability of two muscle groups to co-contract simultaneously. And that would be your pelvic floor, as well as the deeper abdominal muscles. To see why these two muscle groups are important, we have to talk a little bit about breathing. So when you breathe in, your diaphragm descends, and that pushes the abdominal contents, so your intestines, the guts, as I like to say, and the goods, downward. And so then what happens is your pelvic floor has to also descend to catch that viscera, and the ab wall has to stretch out to also make room for those abdominal contents. And then conversely, during exhalation, the pelvic floor ascends or contracts, that pushes the guts upward, the abs engage slightly, which also helps squeeze the guts upward. So for example, if this little ball right here that has these little balls within it was the abdominal contents, when I inhale, stuff gets pushed downward. And then when I exhale, it ought to get pushed back up. Well, folks, what happens if I have a body structure or I'm an individual who struggles creating, or maybe I have less resting tension in the lower abdominals and the pelvic floor? Well, what will happen then is you will have less of an ability to be able to push the abdominal contents upward. Instead, what happens is you have increased muscle activity of the upper abdominals, so think your rectus abdominis, the six-pack muscle. That pulls the sternum slightly down, and then the lower back muscles might push your center of gravity more forward. When that happens, what else do you think shifts its center of mass or location forward? Your abdominal contents, folks. You could think of it this way. Again, if this ball were my abdominal contents, and I have upper musculature contracting, and I have backside musculature contracting, you can see how the contents of the ball or the beads within the ball are now pushed more forward and down. And it has to do with one's body structure predisposing an individual to having more increased muscular activity in the upper abs and the back muscles. And that's biomechanically why someone's abdominal contents might have a tendency to be shifted more down and forward. Now, folks, I keep mentioning body structure when we're talking about the guts moving down and forward, and there's a good reason. Certain skeletal structures have a greater tendency to have the abdominal contents sit down and forward compared to others. If you are someone who's got a narrower rib cage, so you're a little bit more slender side to side, you're going to have this tendency. And that's because this skeletal structure creates a tendency at rest where there is reduced muscular activity in certain portions of the pelvic floor and the lower abs that would allow this tendency to happen. Conversely, these individuals might have greater increased resting muscular tension in some of the back muscles as well as the upper abs. Conversely, if you're someone who has a wider rib cage or you have a wider frame, what can actually happen in that situation is you might still have some of the downward pressure, but generally these folks have increased muscular activity in certain portions of the pelvic floor. And instead of causing their abdominal contents to sit really low, they actually are a little bit more up and forward. So someone who's got a little bit more rounder belly as opposed to having the lower pooch belly, that's those types of individuals. They would require a different intervention movement-wise to be able to address the dynamics of the guts. Now you might be thinking, okay, thanks mom and dad, such jerks. Or maybe you're never gonna listen to that Lady Gaga song again. But no, that's not necessarily the case. Even though someone with a narrower rib cage should have a normal structure, and that's key, folks, this is normal, where the abdominal contents are a little bit more descended, that doesn't mean that we can't manipulate the dynamics of the structure to minimize that tendency. Now, the degree that you can change it is going to depend on the individual, but if we can teach ourselves or our supreme clientele to, instead of having the abdominal contents sit down and forward, if we can increase muscle activity of the lower abs and the pelvic floor, that will push the guts back and upward, or it'll teach us to be able to do that. And theoretically, if we can make that easier, then it's less likely for us to have the tendency to have reduced muscle activity in the lower abs and the pelvic floor, which is a contributing factor to the abdominal contents sitting low. And that's what we're gonna focus on with the latter end of this video. But folks, it would be remiss of me if I didn't also mention some of the other potential contributing factors to having that little lower abdominal bulge or pooch belly. There can be medical reasons why this could be, if there's some sort of structural issue within the gut, you know, hernias, things of that nature, or even like cysts. So you should get medically checked out if it is a big concern. Moreover, there are some times where this can be exacerbated by gut dysbiosis or other gut issues. For example, if you are someone who deals with bloating, AKA your boy, you might have that pooch belly be even more magnified because of the increased gas presence. That increases the size of your abdominal contents, which will magnify that. For example, check out this before and after picture of me. So if you look at me on the left, this would have been about, gosh, 14, 15 years ago. I weighed about the same then as I do now, which is around 170. But what's different here is I was dealing with a lot of gut dysbiosis. I had a ton of bloating. And you can see that the pooch belly is quite a bit more magnified. Conversely, I took this the other day on the right, and you can see that, yeah, I still have a little bit of a pooch belly, but because I've dealt with a lot of my gut issues and I don't have as much bloating anywhere near to the extent that I did back then, it's significantly less pronounced. So you should definitely check out to see if you do have any gut issues or if you have any medical things that need to be addressed. The other thing I think we have to consider is that in some folks, you might have a tendency to carry some of your belly fat in that particular region. And that's can be normal, especially for these individuals who have narrower rib cages. So you still may have to do some interventions if this is something you want to address that involve reducing the amount of body fat that you have. And ideally, you are doing that with a coach or someone who can teach you how to do that in a healthy manner without having a lot of the negative complications that can happen during a fat loss program. However, both of those contributing factors are beyond the scope of this video. I'm gonna go with what you can control immediately, and that is the movement and biomechanics contributions to having a little bit of a pooch belly. Let's go ahead and dive into that next. So our first step is to see if we can get the pelvic floor and the lower abs to work together, because if the guts are down and forward, both of those areas are gonna be a little bit slackened. So we wanna try to get those muscles to kick in a specific way, so that way we can start the process of teaching our bodies to be able to push the guts backward and upward. And so what we're gonna use is a hook lying tilt exercise with a ball squeeze. Now, this is gonna be challenging for a lot of you folks who may be having a pooch belly like your boy. So what you want to do is you want to put a ball between the knees. And I would go ahead and lift, I'm just going to lift my shirt up for demonstration purposes. But you want to start with your feet flat, ball between the knees, hands right below the belly button. Now here's the tricky part, folks. You want to get a little squeeze of the ball. You're going to put a little bit of pressure on your heels, and you want to curl your hips up. This is critical though, folks, without engaging your abs or letting your lower belly come upward, which is most commonly going to be the mistake. So why don't you go ahead and try this with me and see how you do. So I'm going to squeeze, I'm going to get that heel pressure. Abs are jello, they're going to stay jello as I curl my hips towards my knees, just like that, back and forth. Now you should, ideally, if you're doing everything right and you have this coordinated pretty well, your abs should be chilling like Bob Dylan. But the hard thing is a lot of you folks who have the pooch bellies, like me, are very upper ab dominant. So what can oftentimes happen with this move is during the tuck, you might not be able to get the glutes to do the work, not that you're squeezing them or anything, and you'll see this happen. Now, if you zoom in close while I do that, you'll see that my upper rectus abdominis kicks in, my lower abs pooch out. Look familiar? That's kind of the thing we're dealing with. So we don't want to reinforce that, folks. We want to teach our bodies to be able to perform that tilt with the squeeze. The squeeze is going to help the pelvic floor engage, curl the hips out the abs, just like that. So if you look at me now, abs are pretty relaxed and I don't have that issue. Now, the way we're going to get the lower abs engaged in this and not the upper abs is by breathing. But I need you to breathe in a specific way, folks. You're going to go silent in through the nose. Imagine that Michael Myers from the Halloween movies is close by. You don't want him to hear you. On the exhale, it's going to be soft, slow, easy. Don't try so hard. But here's the key. You want to see if the lower part of your abs can get smaller, like coming towards the ground. Not like sucking it in like a drawing maneuver. Home, you don't play that game. You want this to drop down. So I'm going to get that squeeze, heel contact, curl the hips, abs are chill. Let's see if we can get them to engage a little bit. Silent in. Did you hear it? Exactly. Exhale, long sigh. Watch the ab wall. Get smaller and I really feel the lower abs working. Upper abs are pretty relaxed. I'm going to go through it again. So you can see, lower abs are getting smaller, the glutes are in fuego. And so what you want to do is maybe 3 to 5 sets, 5 breaths, seeing if you can coordinate those two things. If you have a hard time not keeping the abs relaxed on the tuck, you can simply work on squeezing, getting the heel pressure and curling up and down, just like this. Now you might be thinking, Zach, you're gonna show me the progression? That's already too difficult. How can we make that move easier? The first thing you can try is elevating your feet. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take my ball, I'm gonna put my feet on an elevated surface. This could be a book at home or a step like this, a box, excuse me. Feet stay flat, squeeze, get your tuck that way. That's gonna make it a little easier and you can practice your tucks. Again, my abs are, they're pretty relaxed in the first one. There's like nothing happening here with this particular move. Then you can go through the same strategies. But what happens if that's still too difficult? Then you can go to this, lying on your side. When you're lying on your side, you're now minimizing the effects of gravity because when you're tucking your hips, you're doing so against gravity. So it's a bit more difficult. You lie on your side, you don't have to sweat that. But you can lie on your side, get basically in the same position, get a little bit of pressure onto the wall, and try the same tucks that way without engaging the abs. Once you got it, you're gonna do the same breaths. Okay, so maybe you're like, Zach, come on, man. That was easy peasy. I got that, nailed it. My tuck is on point. My exhale ain't stale. I need something to kick it up a notch because I'm still dealing with a little bit of bulge in my lower abdomen. Well, folks, in order for us to kick it up to the next level, we have to take advantage of this little thing that we call gravity. To illustrate what I want to do with this next activity, you're going to want to check out this water bottle. if I have a situation in this water bottle where I have a lot of water on the bottom, but I don't have much up top, well, what's an easy way that I could get more water up on the top and less on the bottom? Well, the simple thing is I could tip this puppy upside down. And now you see the uppermost parts are filled with water, the lower part of the bottle, not so much. How does that apply to the next strategy that we're gonna utilize? Well, folks, what if the water was your abdominal contents? If the abdominal contents, the water, are sitting low and you're trying to get them to move up, tipping yourself upside down, utilizing various inversion activities, can be a strategy to help you teach yourself to get the guts to move more easily upward, which could potentially minimize the pooch belly. Now, folks, not everyone's ready to be doing a headstand or all these wild and crazy inversions. So I'm gonna show you the progression that I utilize with my Supreme clientele to practice slowly tipping them up to an inverted position, which, once you get this, no one will mess with you. So if I don't have the ability to go completely upside down, well, if I keep the bottom, my bottom half, higher than my top half, I can still get a lot of water going up top. We're gonna use the same principle here with our first exercise, which is a quadruped on elbows activity. So with this particular move, what you wanna do is you wanna get down on your forearms, have your stance a little bit wider like this, and you want your rear in the air like so, but you're not sagging like this. Now, a mistake a lot of people make with this particular activity is they'll really tuck the hips like this. Well, the problem, folks, is when you do that, it's kind of the same mistake that you might have made with the hook line tilt. So on this particular move, I don't really coach much of a tuck anymore. What you want to think about is we're going to drive this more with our upper body. You want to slowly push your forearms down in the ground and let your upper back move towards the ceiling. Eyes are staying on the fingertips. Now, the way we're gonna get the guts to move upward, aside from the effects of gravity, is through the breathing sequence that you just used. So if you can kind of remember that sensation that you created when you were on your back, you want the same sensation here in terms of what I'm doing with the ab wall. So I'm gonna get that reach, eyes on the fingertips, silent in through the nose, exhale, I'm gonna make the ab wall smaller just like I did on my back. And you can kind of see, if you look at my upper body, kind of expanding and getting larger. Which, that's essentially me moving the water to the higher segments, meaning that the guts are not gonna be sitting as low, they're gonna be moving up higher. At least I'm teaching my body to do that. Now, if you practice that, and you're not doing a lot of the common screw-ups, which are sagging, over tucking, crunching when you reach, those are the things you wanna be mindful of, right? You're gonna keep this nice reach, get your exhales. You can make it a bit more challenging by adding a decline to the mix. So what I'm gonna do for that is get something to elevate my legs on. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put my knees on this box, and now I'm tipping myself further upside down. I'm gonna get the same reach without crunching. Not gonna tuck the hips wild and crazy. Eyes on the fingertips, same breathing. In the exhale, abs are getting smaller and I'm not sagging. Perhaps you nailed those two moves and you're easy. You're like, Zach, I'm ready to tip the water bottle upside down. What you got for me? I'm gonna show you the easiest headstand variation that I'm gonna incorporate, because that's what we're gonna have to use. If I tip the water bottle completely upside down, I'm gonna be on my noggin. So the way I coach this is from the ground, what you wanna do is you wanna grip your fingers on the back of your head like so. So I'm gonna have my palms on the back of my head. I'm gonna have my elbows down on the ground. Now, you wanna make sure that you're not doing this crunchy thing as you get into position. That's the most common error that I see with the headstand. Because when you do the crunch, guess what? That's the pooch belly coming out. We want to minimize that because that's going to engage more of the upper abs, whereas we want the lower abs. And we also want the pelvic floor doing its thing. You're not going to feel the pelvic floor so much, but you kind of get what I'm saying. So you want to make sure that you don't crunch and you want to, when you're in this position, create a little bit of a reach through the elbows like so. So I got my fingertips here. I'm gonna push the elbows into the ground like this without crunching. So my head's not gonna leave the ground. My head's staying in contact with the ground and I'm pushing through the elbows like that, all right? Now, from here, what you're gonna do is you're gonna lift the knees up, keep them bent. You don't wanna straighten them. If you straighten the knees, what will happen is you'll create a lot of bend through your back, which again is not a bad thing, right? You're not gonna hurt yourself. But what that will do is that will limit how well the viscera will be able to move upward. We wanna keep the knees bent because that helps us encourage a good pelvic position. So that way we can get the pelvic floor to ascend. We get the pelvic floor to ascend, guess what? That's gonna reverse some of the stuff that we talked about with the pooch belly. So let's go ahead and practice that. Palms on your head, head's on the ground. I get the elbow push, the head's staying on the ground, it's not lifting up. Knees are gonna come up, I'm gonna walk my knees in my chest as best I can, hold and breathe. Keeping that elbow pressure. Whew. Now, you might feel like, wow, it's super restricted when I breathe in that position. And that's okay, because you're likely going to be a little bit more restricted if you present with this particular posture. Over time, you keep chilling in that position, the amount that you breathe should improve. But let's say that's not enough, and you wanna go with an even more difficult version. You can apply the same principle that we did with the decline. So I can also tip myself over the top even further by putting my legs on some type of elevated surface, like so. So I can get in the same position. I'm gonna start like I did with the decline. Gonna get my head on the ground. I'm gonna keep my head there, press through the elbows, lift the knees up, walk it forward. Now I can get a little more easily over the top, hold and breathe. You'll notice with all of these moves, a lot of them we were just staying in one position, chilling, breathing, all this stuff. But that's not how we live day-to-day life. We gotta move. So I'm gonna show you next one of my favorite moves to utilize that's gonna teach us to place our abdominal contents exactly where we want them, get the lower abs kicking in like crazy, and teach you to get into a position to where the pelvic floor can do its thing so you minimize the abdominal position that creates the pooch belly. And this move, folks, is what I affectionately call the Cicinelli turtle roll. I got this move from my buddy Joe Cicinelli. He's a really good PT. If you're out in the Bay Area, definitely hit him up. And evidently it's also a Pilates move, but I didn't know that. Joe taught it to me, and it's way more fun to say his name on camera because he gets angry. So we're gonna go with it. Here's how you're gonna do this. What you wanna do is you wanna get a yoga block, and you're going to put the yoga block between your knees, which are together, and your elbows, which are together. Once you have that, you're gonna take your hands, place it on your forehead, and you're gonna press. So I'm gonna press my elbows and knees into the block. I already feel some phenomenal abdominals kicking in. Now, a lot of people will try to crunch this. We do not want that. That's why I'm keeping the palms on my forehead. This is basically gonna try to lock my head in place so I don't do this. If you flex the neck, and I can already feel it, folks, I'm getting the rectus abdominis, the upper part, to kick in. I want the lower to kick in, all right? Now, what I like about this move is it's very self-limiting and there's a progression built into it. Your goal is you wanna roll back and forth until you can get up. On the backwards part of the roll, you're gonna inhale silently. On the forward part, you're gonna exhale. And you wanna just go at the pace of your breath, so it's gonna be a little faster than some of the other moves. But you wanna be able to get up without using your head and while also keeping the block in place. If you can't do it, you gotta find an easier way. The easiest is going to be having the block be long like this. The most difficult would be knees to chest, and then in between that you can, instead, if this is too easy, you can go like that. So I'm getting the knees to chest closer, and then that's even closer, just like that. The more you can get up into that position, the more easily you'll be able to teach yourself to be able to move the guts upward. And so we're gonna start with the easy setting. Knees together, elbows together, back of the hands on the face, my palms on my face, excuse me. I'm getting that pressure
Inhale, roll back. Exhale, forward. And just keep going back and forth until you get up. Just like that.
Folks, it's way harder than it looks. My abs are feeling pretty torched from that. If you got it and it's easy, then you would go to the next rung.
See how I do? But same song and dance, keeping everything close.
Yeah, that was definitely harder. And so there's some nice easy progressions built into that. If by some chance you can't get into this position
right here with the yoga block like this,
and you've done the other stuff and that's easy, the other option could be to get like a half foam roller.
That way you're getting a little closer or a little bit more distance between your knees and your elbows.
But that's basically the move, and that's the last tier of things that I would give most of my Supreme clientele to focus on improving some of the dynamics that are associated with the pooch belly. And there you have it, folks. Those are the biomechanics behind a pooch belly, as well as movement-wise what you need to be able to do to try to minimize the movement component of the pooch belly and maximize the dynamics in the ab wall. If you found this video useful, please, while you're here, hit the like and subscribe button because it does help the fam keep growing, and I'll continue to produce content like this to help you reach your movement goals. Otherwise, thank you so much for tuning in. You've been an incredible, outstanding audience, and I hope that you keep it real but not to the extent where things go wrong. Stay hungry, stay learning, stay moving. I'll see you next time. Deuces.